Hello, welcome to another Venga Room Collections. We've been brought back to Scotland ahead of the Valentine's Day True shows later in the week. I'm very fortunate to be in the home of Johnny and his friend Keith. Well, not they don't live
it's
together.
On my home, yeah.
But we're back for another collection series with Optimo once again. At the end of the last one, we kind of decided we should probably do another one just because there was so much to cover. And this show's going to have a little bit of a running theme, isn't it?
So we're going to talk about the music that we would play when we did the weekly club, which was every Sunday for 12 years. For us, the first hour was quite an important part of the club.
All right, so it's kind of, should we stick something on?
Yeah, what would so be the if first we're talking of 50s swing, this is not 50s swing, but you know, quite often we would start the night with this exotic atmosphere. Like I say, it would change all the time. And some amazing records, 1950s, the thing about the recording of them is just phenomenal. We think we live in a very advanced technological time, but back then they were able to make records sound absolutely fantastic. Mm. So let's start. Came out and they made these series of records to make people, you could test how great your hi-fi sounded, so they were beautifully recorded, but they were just really percussion records. So there's, I think there's like 20 in the series, and I picked that up for $5.
I mean, I guess another sort of role of the warm-up is to sort of do the final checks of sound, and I suppose records like this that are so nicely produced are perfect for
absolutely.
That. I don't know how much of that came into your mind when you're selecting stuff for the warm-up, but where should we take it next?
Well, we were also something we would play some quite extreme records. This is from the late 60s. I guess it could be called free jazz. I mean, I think it's beautiful, but I think for a lot of people it was maybe this kind of record where this was, I guess there wasn't, you wouldn't go outside to smoke then because you could smoke in the club, but people maybe find a little excuse to go out and get a breath of fresh air. But I think so. If you know this, the track from Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon, the great gig in the sky, they ripped off the idea from this, but made it a little bit more palatable.
Thank you. it's nice to, it is nice to sort of start the night with fairly weird records.
It is.
When later on in the night, when you pull something out that's maybe a little bit.
But again, is it having that freedom where you know you have an audience who are there and they're not going to go away? You know, it would be rare to have the balls. I mean, someone like Kieran Hebden might have the balls to play that in the middle of a techno set, but most people would.
I think both Keith and I, I've got we're both into kind of quite sleazy music, and we used to play a lot of like stuff like Las Vegas grind music and
script kind of music,
music, and we used to call them Optimo titty shakers, and we'd play. You know, it was a big element, I suppose, of the club, that kind of
the titty shakers,
that kind of. And with the lights, we'd always only have red light in the club, and but quite a sleazy atmosphere. Yeah. It kind of fitted the bill, I suppose, for that end of things. I'd say a friend of ours asked if she could come and strip at the club one night. You need a license to have a stripper,
really,
you know.
That was not a really bad idea.
So that was a terrible idea as well.
How does stripper grams do it?
We thought she would do it.
You know, a bit of racy dancing or something, or you know, something a bit salacious on the wee stage you put up. I mean, like, literally 2 minutes into the thing, she was topless, and, you know, and cavorting around the around the place, and we're like, oh, we're going to get.
So I guess off the back of spending so much time and energy planning what you're going to bring to Spacey on a Sunday, how did that affect the gigs? Would you take a similar bag, or would you just have a sort of generic bag?
No, we'd take very different records when we went elsewhere. I mean, there was, you know, the dance part of the night, and those records we would probably play when we went elsewhere. But there were certain records, you know, having a residency where you're there every week, you can make certain records become very popular. Mm. And you can play them knowing that the first time you play them, people aren't going to get them. Maybe the second, the third, but eventually you can turn that track into something that everyone knows and falls in love with. You can take extreme risks with music. When you go to another club, it's hard to have the balls to do. I mean, sometimes we will do that. And sometimes you can go somewhere and you can sense that this crowd is really open to whatever you're going to do. You can take it. But in my opinion, I think clubs have become a lot more conservative. I think for to try and do these really strange records in most clubs, especially when you need to get a 90-minute or a 2-hour set, or a festival or something, it's almost impossible to do something like that. So we would definitely have the records that we would play at the club, and the records we would take.
But it's maybe where we got that reputation for being a bit difficult, or where, you know, some people would, would say, you know, eclectic, just because we were play something that was a wee bit, you know, incongruous with the rest of the, you know, and it's yeah, maybe that's where that's come from, you know. But as I say, it was all because we were just having a great time.
And, so
thank you.
So, yeah,
I think I think as well, and you know, we're talking about the idea that of a broadcast being, you know, when we're doing the party in the first hour and stuff like that, we'd play some quite difficult, quite noisy, quite offensive music sometimes as well. So, and I think Thrill and Gristle have always been synonymous with Optimo, and I wanted to play a Thrill and Gristle. Because we never really shied away from playing like really pretty noisy and
literally stand and dance, no matter what we played, we'd dance, and then you'd notice other people would kind of, depending what they would come and go, which is also nice, because usually DJing, it's about keeping a dance floor there all the time. At this point of the night, it was, you know, people would get up, and then they would go away again, and then it didn't really matter.